Bleach episode 5 has come in with an absolute banger this week, and not to say that the other weeks haven't been bangers, because they have, but not as much as this particular one, because just like this episode, the other episodes were in fact setup episodes as well, but this one had something a little bit more different in comparison to its contemporaries, and that was impact. There's a lot to talk about in this episode, and maybe a little bit of controversy as well. So if you like this type of videos, please hit the like and subscribe, because again, it means a lot. So without further ado, let's get into it. Before I talk about the little bits of controversies within this episode, I want to talk about the two main things that happened within this episode, which was the first half being Byakuya versus Asnodt, and the second half being Yamamoto versus, I guess, everyone, question mark? And it's these two moments in the episodes which really strike you the most, because on the first half, you have a fear aspect, which is something I said in my spoilers video, which I do recommend you go check out the spoiler videos that I do every single week. I specified that I really wanted a horror aspect in this episode, and it was integral and it was important. I didn't want any high animation in this episode whatsoever, as long as they got the theme of horror correctly. And to my pleasant surprise, we got a little bit of both, because the way they really hammered in the horror aspect and the fear factor of this episode was fantastic, and really showed off and displayed Asnodt's abilities as a whole. And then the other side of the episode was a bit of hope within all this darkness that we experienced through the first half of the episode, coming in with a bit of hype, a bit of excitement, a bit of light in the darkness, so to say. But of course, let's talk about some things I liked first, which is the little intricate details of maybe some interesting foreshadowings, such as, for example, and you may have missed it, the black to white get-together. Now, of course, we all know that Ichigo is stuck within the jail that Kurage had unfortunately bestowed upon him. Because of this, his contact towards the Soul Society has been cut off, but he can in fact hear them on the other side. During this time, Ichigo has been trying to get out of the jail with his get-together tenshos and normal swing slashes, which have for the most part been black get-togers. Now the interesting thing is, as you see throughout the episode and we keep panning back to Ichigo, these get-togers are getting more white. And this is for manga readers, we can kind of assume where this is going and where this is alluding to. You're getting little glimpses of how Ichigo is able to get out of this, as well as the foundations of how that comes to be. As well as in the manga and in the anime as well, we get to see a green sort of spiritual energy, which I'm guessing is a little bit of a testament to maybe the Fullbringer energy, because we kind of see that within the Bringer light. So just throwing a little guess out there, haven't gone to research it, just off the dome. With that being said, we also get some foreshadowings to some Stone Ritter that we haven't actually been introduced to yet, which has been really interesting as well. We get some really cool added content with Meninas, for example. It wasn't Giselle, it wasn't Candice, it was Meninas. Seems to have powerhoused Rukia to the floor, because again, spoilers, I won't go into too much of that. And we also get a little foreshadowing of Pepe as well, showing his staff if the leg itself wasn't foreshadowing enough. Again, it wouldn't be if you were not a manga reader. We also did get a little bit of foreshadowing in towards Giselle as well. Unfortunately, we don't get to see them, but we get that allusion through Jidambo. And we also get a little bit of foreshadowing towards the Sigma as well. Now, I am interested to see where they go with the Sigma, because the Sigma is a bit of an anomaly when it comes to the Thousand Year Blood War arc. He was there, but then he wasn't, kind of thing. In fact, I think he even got touched upon in the light novels, but not even in the manga itself. So it's going to be interesting to see how they're actually going to enforce Sigma, whether they're going to go much further into him, because I, for one, would quite like that, to be honest with you. Maybe later on towards the end of the war, who knows? Again, it's going to be nice to see where they go with that. Now, granted, we all knew what was going to happen with Ruki because Kubo told us in an interview, but you know, if they didn't or did show us, it doesn't really matter either way. It was a nice thing that they didn't have to do, and I appreciated it nonetheless. Would I have preferred Robert doing a 360 no scope on a random Soul Reaper when fighting Shunsui? Maybe, but to be honest, it's one of those things where it's cut, but it doesn't really matter and doesn't really change anything. So I think I much prefer the Meninas scene to that 360 no scope, though it is cool and it would have been cool to have anyway. But again, no stresses there. Things are going to get cut that seem maybe unnecessary to the director. But again, it is interesting because we do get to see the Sigma's daggers hit next to Rukia and hit next to other Soul Reapers, which again makes sense because those daggers that you see are able to teleport certain Stone Ritters to certain places. So again, I hope the anime really does go into depth a little bit about that, or showcase that a little bit, because I think many people watching this episode may be a little bit confused as to what the point was showing those daggers were. Now let's talk about a little bit of controversy, and many of you may not have picked this up, but there was in fact a flashback with Byakuya Byakuya as Asnodt, you know, taunting him about fear, about fighting, about how prideful he is, blah, 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 all that sort of stuff. And in these flashbacks that we get to see a flashback of a filler character, in quotation, being Koga. Now, I will demonstrate that while this scenario never technically happened, and though I wonder why they specifically chose this scene, which they didn't really need to, Koga as a character, as well as Muramasa, are in fact canon characters that exist within the Bleach universe. Unfortunately, those timelines didn't exist. That's why I'm a little bit questionable on why they added it in. But because of the flashback that they used with Koga, doesn't imply the timeline of when it happened, nor does it imply the events of which happened. It was just two characters on screen with no context, so you can kind of get away with it. But yes, Koga and Muramasa do exist within the universe of Bleach canonically. And this is also reinstated within the Can't Fear Your Own World light novels, Volume 2. I believe, because that's like saying Byakuya's dad doesn't exist, even though his dad does exist. Just because we haven't seen him and we only saw him once on a color page doesn't mean he doesn't exist and he doesn't have a Zanpakuto that isn't in the Soul Reaper records, etc, etc. We're going off the topic, but you know what I mean. Another awesome thing I want to throw in there as well is the free Stone Ritter that Kenpachi absolutely bodied. I was surprised in my live reaction that they threw this in, though my fingers were crossed, and I was not disappointed that the question, the roar, and Lloyd, I forgot his script from the top of my head as I'm recording this, but I am glad that they got somewhat, even if it's a few seconds or a minute of extra screen time. That was really fantastic. However, Kubo did in fact cook us a little bit, because we still don't know what the question actually does, but it's heavily implied due to a little bit of thought process. But the roar was interesting. Jerome, he basically roars and, you know, decapitates people with his roar. Pretty straightforward, nothing too special. Kenpachi cut him. The next one was Bernice, the question. Apparently Bernice can question or object to Kenpachi himself, or question things that he does, which I would imagine makes something redundant, or makes something less powerful, or makes something not happen. We could go into a whole nother discussion about that, maybe its own video, I don't know. It seems like a bunch of nothing, but it's actually funny because Kubo said that he added extra lines for Bernice, yet at the same time we're still as clueless as we was in the manga a little bit. So no love for Bernice, I'm afraid. So if any of you Bernice fans out there, yeah, no, not happening. But still a good maybe concept, maybe. And then of course we had Lloyd, which turned himself into Kenpachi and gave Kenpachi a good fight, which is really cool, because in fact I see it as a little bit of a foreshadowing for my homies out there that know, for Kenpachi and Kenpachi to fight each other, and Kenpachi just having to strengthen himself up, or maybe breaking a limit for him to be the stronger Kenpachi and then body the fake one. Though I will say it was a nice callback for anyone that is a Raigai arc fan, because even though that was filler, we get to see Kenpachi versus Kenpachi in that arc, and we got to see it in this arc in a canonical setting, which was nice. So I overall enjoyed that. I'm glad that they gave them a little bit of screen time. And then of course was something interesting as well, which was Hoshwald. In the manga, Hoshwald mentioned about Byakuya's death. Granted, you can take this with a grain of salt. It's not a spoiler whether he is or isn't, granted. However, in the anime, Hoshwald doesn't mention this, which goes to show that they may be sticking with their guns on the decision that Kubo made, and they're not going to change any routes, is the kind of prediction or assumption that can be made here. So if that is the case and it was cut from the anime, it can be heavily implied that in the manga that things were in fact changed because of that fan backlash. And yeah, that's a whole nother situation. You can Google that. There was a whole history on that if you really want to dig into the rabbit hole. But it's an interesting one nonetheless, so I did find that a little bit interesting. And I think the creme de la creme of all this was Chojuro. I'm so surprised and happy that Chojuro finally got his backstory, and we got to see him use the Bankai, and got to see his little, you know, how he met Genryusai Yamamoto, what Yamamoto's names were before it was Genryusai, and also see just how beautiful Chojuro's Bankai is and how elegant it is. And I think if Chojuro Sasakibe does embody anything, it is eloquence. And you know, even though we got a little bit upset with the fact that Byakuya's speech on Chojuro was taken away in episode 2, it was definitely reiterated within this episode, where Yamamoto talks about how Chojuro's name was etched within the Soul Society and was respected by all. It kind of gave the same message and kind of showcased just how strong Chojuro was going from that little mini fight that him and Yamamoto had. But yes, I was very happy to see how his Bankai looked, and I was very surprised. Again, you can see the live reaction. I'm being genuine. I think it looks cool, and it didn't disappoint. Other than that, this episode was orgasmic when it came to effects. I mean, to be fair, this episode could have been absolute still frames and the effects completely carried. From things such as Rukia's face, the Rukia scene as a whole was done absolutely beautifully. I couldn't have asked for anything better than that. It was fluid, it was horrific, it was scary, it showed Byakuya's weakness. We got to see a demeanor from Byakuya we'd never seen before, and the character acting, unironically, from Byakuya, who is usually calm, composed, skillful within his swordsmanship, we got to see him be sloppy, stiff, aggressive with his sword, and that was something we haven't seen from Byakuya before, so it's good to see him fall out of touch with his own character and his own, I guess, masquerade, so to say, that it even shocked Renji. So that was really cool. Renji absolutely got absolutely hammered by Master Masculine, and I thought that that was a cool scene as well. But I think for me, what really makes a good horror setting is when it makes the viewer itself kind of cringe a little bit or go ew, and that was definitely with the fly scene. It was CG, and it was beautiful CG at that, because it was beautifully encompassed with the 2D animation and it didn't look out of place, but it almost gave you like secondhand feeling, to which is a great and fantastic job that any animator can recreate. So through these past two episodes, you've seen the Soul Society get absolutely bodied, low morale, and you've had it all sprinkled in with this last interaction with Byakuya absolutely get decimated to a point of where everybody's kind of questioning, is Byakuya dead? A fan favorite captain, a captain that's been with us since the beginning, a captain who's established how strong he is, and then to see him get absolutely decimated where the enemy isn't even going 100% is giving the idea that this is a war. And that is the point that I don't see from many anime arcs, is that they can't define a war very well. This is one-sided, it's not fun, there's no hope here. The hope that does exist is dwindling extremely rapidly, and that's where we really tie into things with Yamamoto Genri Yusai coming in as pissed as he's ever been. And all these episodes have really done well for Yamamoto, building up to this tension, building up to these bottled emotions, to have Yamamoto really express that through his eyes, by his body language, and through his absolute rage of putting Sasakibe finally to rest by burning Driscoll in literally a one-arm swoop. And that goes to show how strong Yamamoto is. And again, Yamamoto is a character that we've seen again through the start of the series. We've never seen him fight. He's the big dog. He's the best of the best as far as we know. So to see him finally be on the front lines was a fantastic way to introduce just how serious this is, and to give everyone, not only the audience, but also the cast of the crew of the series, a lot of motivation as well. And to end off this amazing episode, we get a post-credit scene of Kenpachi's being held by the neck, looking like he was about to die. And why this is important as well is, other than Byakuya, everybody knows how much of a durable powerhouse Kenpachi is. Ruthless, savage, instinctual, has no hesitation in the things that he does, and will take the killing blow when it comes. He is the absolute epitome of a guy that is the most fearsome soul reaper in the divisions. And yet he got absolutely dwindled down to a husk of a nobody. And that right there goes to show you that our main villain is more than anything we've ever seen, even after Aizen. So I hope you liked the review. Tell me your thoughts in the comment section down below. With that being said, please like and subscribe, and of course, you guys of course have these fine, I've been Hansen, and peace out.